The George Strait Experience asks, is it time for Jerry the owner to fire Jerry the flight attendant daddy? Okay, you've got a few things wrong with this, but I see where you're going. It's comedy, George. Don't shake your head. Stop waving off comedy. You're always... You have those little
airport
runway flashlights, and you're always waving off comedy.
That's not true. I'm always awaiting comedy.
Did you want those things when you were a kid? The little flashlight signalers that the guys on the runway would tell the plane where to go?
Still do.
Those are so cool. Certainly you can buy them, right?
No
way. You can order them online?
No way.
Or is that only at the professional grade equipment store that you must have a federal license to buy?
Yep.
This comes to us from Chris. He says the Cowboys' identity for 2023 was definitely the "Here we go." So we got to retire it now, right?
Yeah,
got to.
Yeah,
it's next year that
it was fun while it lasted.
It wasn't even fun.
Quit waving off fun. That's what you do.
I'm telling you,
you're
that
trying
people,
to have fun at a football game and you just wave it off. Gordon?
People know I'm right. First of all, that's point one. The second point is right.
And worse.
To me, it was like water torture. It was like being waterboarded watching Cowboys games because we heard, here we go, about 1,500 times this year. It just got really old.
Yeah.
Yeah. It did. It's still real to me.
Corey says, Gordon, you were almost where I've been thinking about Dak in your segment on mental support in the corner yesterday. I do believe NFL teams have mental health support with each team, but these are therapists that are there for the mental health of a person. What I feel you missed in communicating in the segment is separating that from the mental performance coach. Do the Cowboys have a mental performance coach in addition to the mental health people? These are people who are driving mental support to make the player perform success on the field. And he mentions that they have these in high-profile CEOs and the financial industry and things like that. That is what I was talking about, Corey. I was talking about the mental health of the person that leads to being a mental health coach. I mean, that leads into mental health coaching, that gets your performance better on the field because your head is right. And it was an interesting discussion that we had yesterday on that, and I think that certainly teams are paying more attention to it. I just don't know if they've gone so far as to make the distinction that you've made, which is a good one, which is what about our mental health coaches, not just the therapist, but the coach that gets you to the performance level that you need to be at. Now, formerly, it's always been the job of the head coach to be the mental health coach. You want the coach that gives inspiring speeches. You want the coach that teaches you how to deal with adversity.
Jimmy.
Yeah, Jimmy.
Using his psychology.
Yeah, I have to at least acknowledge that that is what we're talking about, is using psychology when you're a coach.
Mm-hmm. He's finally on our side.
Finally.
But there, I think teams would do well to have a dedicated mental health coach, health performance coach, because there has to be some research into this. You mean to tell me that in all the things that we've researched and scientized and gotten studies on, we haven't studied what actually works? You know, it's almost like the analytics of mental health coaching.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know that we have our old conventional wisdom, which is a coach, here's a great old saying, and then here's what you do with adversity, you do this here. But where are the studies? Where's the science that backs up, oh, you know what, actually that isn't the best message. We find it actually is, it's kind of counterintuitive, but the better message is this, or whatever. Where are those studies and that science?
Well, that's a great question, and my gut is they're out there, or at least there's been one by now, because it's been so talked about the last few years. But you're right, I've never seen one.
I haven't either. And it's such a huge part of sports. And here we're a sports station, and we've never really seen that or talked about that at length. The science of coaching, the mental aspect.
I do have a brother who has a master's in sports psychology, and that's what he wants to do is do a private practice for that or maybe join a team, but it is out there. He got it from the University of Denver.
Yeah, we do have a sports psychologist, but I've always heard that term, and maybe it's a failure of mine. It's like I've never known how sports psychology was different than regular psychology, but it makes sense that that would be the specific application of psychology in sports has to have some new studies.
Can you ask your brother if these studies exist? He may know.
Yeah, so I've talked to him a little bit about it, and he says they do learn what methods are most effective to help with performance, and it varies by sport, obviously, and position, but he coaches baseball as well, and he'll actively use what he's learned to try and get kids out of slumps and get them the right mental approach at the plate, and there are studies out there that do that.
And then didn't we have one in studio once? I'm remembering now that there was a sports psychologist sitting over there once.
Dr. Carlton Maxwell.
Yeah.
No, not Dr. Carlton Maxwell. Although I do believe that we will talk with him either today or tomorrow.
Good.
Well, good.
We need to.
So that's coming up.
I always think of the scene from The Natural with the sports psychologist in the clubhouse talking to the team, to the Knights. Losing is a disease. As contagious as bubonic plague.
I don't remember that.
I don't remember that either.
Yeah, that sounds... I haven't watched that movie in a long time.
I haven't either. It was an overrated movie.
Oh, come on.
I don't know why everyone went so crazy over The Natural.
I don't know why you just can't embrace a movie every once in a
while.
Well,
I do embrace lots
you
of
seem
movies.
You seem to body slam every sports movie
I tell you
ever
the
made.
Ones that I love.
Gave us that song.
Hey, yeah, that song is great. Run. And when the Rangers would play that, I thought that was great. When they would play it at the... I guess they still do, right?
Yeah,
I think that's fantastic. I'm just saying the movie itself. Yeah. I just didn't understand what was so great about it. It's kind of like Unforgiven by Clint Eastwood. I got to go revisit that one because that one seemed real Emperor's New Clothes to me. I mean, if you want a good sports movie,
this ought to be good.
Life of Brian or Sling Blade. Those are awesome movies. I love those movies. So, yeah, and another thing that I would love to ask a real sports psychologist is what has changed? If we've had sports psychology for 20 years as a specific field of psychology, you know, what has the evidence changed over those 20 years? Because every science progresses. And if it doesn't progress, then to me, it's not really science.
Mm-hmm.
It's just kind of teaching a belief system. What did they start off recommending to athletes versus what do they do now? Mm-hmm. And what's the latest in sports psychology?
These are all good questions mm-hmm. for Dr. Maxwell.
Stop programming the station on the fly. Although that's what we do all the time. Okay, what's in a name? There was a woman named Sam Hart, and she put out... a video that went kind of viral talking about how, please, parents, think about the way you name your kid and all the possible implications of it. Because she shared her very uncomfortable, she's in her late 20s, I think, her uncomfortable experience in the workplace dealing with the name that her parents did not think through.
Uh-oh.
Well, when we get company email... oftentimes, what is it? It's your first initial and your last name and then your company name,
mm-hmm.
at company name.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think Sam Hart's email address looks like?
F.
What?
Sam Hart?
Yeah.
Oh, Sam.
What do you think I said, fam?
I was thinking of the last name being Hart, and I was thinking something to make it funny, and if there was an F, it'd be fart.
No.
But yeah, Sam, Chart.
Chart,
yes.
At Cumulus.
She's had to deal with that. She said she didn't realize that her name was a problem until when she was a teenager and her parents got her personalized plates for a car that said that word on the back of it. And she wasn't familiar with the word, but her boyfriend at the time says, sweetie, you know what that says?
Okay.
Hey, what does that mean? I don't know. Why?
In fairness to the parents,
I don't think that was a term.
I don't think it was
her.
Either. I think it's a last 20-year term.
First I ever heard that term was in the...
Along Came Polly.
Yeah.
From the great Sanford Lyle.
Philip Seymour Hoffman.
He had to leave the party because he just sharted. And then he had to explain what that was to Ben Stiller.
But yeah, I mean, she's good looking too. Would that ruin it for you if you had to refer to her as that all the time?
Yeah, I don't care.
You don't care? Mm-mm. You kind of like that?
I don't know if I like
that. I kind of like that.
He would say something like that. That's a former coworker of ours.
That's a funny one, but it's not that bad. I mean,
I prefer it after like they sweat it up really, a little bit. I like it when they work into a lather.
Do you
down
really
there
think she had to put up with a lot growing up?
Yes, if those were her plates.
The plate thing, yeah. But I mean, just in everyday life, no. She was Samantha or Sam.
She says that she even had at one job, the HR approached her saying, hey, look, this is our naming convention. We are requesting that you go by a different email.
Yeah. To your point, George, no for the first 15 years of her life. Because you rarely saw S.
Once the plates rolled in.
But then, once the plates rolled in, and then she goes to work and gets an email address, then she took hell.
There was another woman who responded to one of her videos that in the comments and said that her name was Sue Heartlove, and she's had the same problem.
Heartlove.
Jeez. Oh, my goodness. So just be careful what all you right name your kid. And all those people that named their kid Karen way back when, I'm sure that's a tough one, pal.
Funny stuff. Okay, thanks, Gordo. That's the ODEC.
Well, it was 30 degrees warmer this morning than it was yesterday morning. Felt good where I was.
You bet.
No 40s coat, no nothing. It was above freezing. So we have a relatively warm day today, and then it's going to get cold again. Is today the warmest day of the week? I think.
Yeah, 53 maybe for a high today.
Which is perfect.
Then Arctic front tomorrow.
Yeah, another it's one going to get cold again. But it's not going to stay below freezing all day for the next few days, will it? I mean, today, yes, but
no
the next couple days. So the good news is, of course, is that the threat of ice is kind of over. But we have to deal with our cars right now. Is your car filthy with all of the salt and dirt? You got to get that salt off your car, that brine off your car, because it will eat up your car. That's why cars from the north, no one wants rust those out. If they've been, you know, shipped down here to sell, it's much more desirable to buy a used car that's always stayed in the south than one that was up in the north for a while. Because of the salt they put on the roads, gets on the car, and you're going to want that undercoat.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you got to protect the underside of that car with that undercoat. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Still into Fargo. Watched a little bit more last night.
I watched the finale last night.
Dang it. You've already seen the finale?
Yep.
Dang.
So great.
Way ahead.
I'm only in, like, episode 4. But that dude, that crazy 500-year-old dude of...
What?
Monk.
Yeah.
500-year-old.
It's something weird. I saw a flashback where 500 years ago he was alive back then.
Okay, well, he was on death's doorstep, and he ate the sins of the wealthy, and that gave him eternal life. But
it's like a Gordo bit.
I know. But it sounds very jump the sharky.
But he became a mercenary.
You do not tell the man that this is a tiger.
What? I don't know. His weird speeches. No, and...
weird accent.
Oh, gosh. I love those bad guys. I put him in that same classification as Anton Chigurh.
Yes.
Like even the original blonde guy from the Fargo movie who was all quiet and just sat there smoking while driving the car. It was all creepy. But far, and you've seen much farther than I have in Fargo episode or season 5. No one tops Anton Chigurh, though. He's still not better than Anton Chigurh.
No, he's really close.
Uh-huh.
But no, not better.
George, you've seen No Country, right?
Does he ask me that weekly?
Yes.
It's a weekly thing.
He's seen
it. I've seen it, Gordon, and I don't think it's the greatest movie ever made like you do. I think it's good.
Whoa.
But I'm not, that's not my theme. I'm not into that like you are. You love murders and creepy characters.
Whoa, wait a second.
Okay, well, the way she got shot with a nail gun was amazing.
I like well-crafted movies. That's what you meant to say.
Right. That's what I meant.
Did you like it when Chigurh had that state trooper on the side of the road? And he just be still for a second.
God.
Just stun.
No, it's
and then puts the pneumatic cow stunner up to the guy's forehead.
No, I didn't like that.
I'm always creeped out by the villain who is so calm and 100% sure he's getting away with this crime he's about to commit.
Yes. Which Chigurh was certainly that. Okay. What were we talking about? Oh, rusting out vehicles. So get your car cleaned. Mm-hmm. Go through the car wash or rinse it off yourself. Here's a new resort that's coming to Lake Texoma. Hard Rock International will begin construction in March of a 189-room hotel and conference center on Lake Texoma. $1 billion they're going to spend on this thing.
It is not.
2,700-acre master-planned resort community on the west side of Roosevelt Memorial Bridge near Kingston, Oklahoma.
Okay.
And this goes along with, there's the Chickasaw development that they have up there. They have a casino up there that has a big resort. There's another one that the Craig Ranch people are doing up off Texoma.
Oh, really?
All these, wow. Resort destinations so you can live out there on the shores of Texoma, which is now being considered one of the Great Lakes.
It's a big lake, but it doesn't have a lot of buildings on it because that lake goes up and down.
What do you mean?
It varies a lot. Like,
oh, it does?
Yeah. But maybe they're going to.
So at one point, your home is 100 yards from the shore, and at another point, it's.
You're bailing water.
Texoma attracts 7 million visitors a year. It is the country's. Oh, how do you think it ranks as far as size of reservoirs? In the country.
In the country.
The fact that you're just mentioning this means it must be near the top of the list.
I'm going to say top 5.
Number 1! 14.
Yeah.
14.
It's pretty good.
It's the biggest in the Texas and
Oklahoma.
It is
the biggest in the Texas.
I've always found it fascinating that Texas only has one natural lake.
Caddo.
Yeah.
Does that not make your brain crazy?
A little.
With as much square mileage as we have in this state, there's only one natural lake.
Yeah.
And every other one we had to build.
Or just dam up some rivers.
How many lakes do you think have been created off of the Colorado River?
Colorado Rockies?
Colorado River.
No.
Anupama.
Or the Brazos. Which one has the most lakes?
Let's see. You go Possum Kingdom, back to the Brazos, Granbury, Whitney. That's 4. Am I leaving out one? I don't think so.
White Rock.
Colorado, not White Rock. Colorado has LBJ, Buchanan, Travis.
God, he's pretty good at all this.
Falls,
look at him.
4 or 5 there.
It's You're close. Dominating.
It's close.
Does that mean we basically live in a desert state?
Pretty much.
We have just one lake.
We just dammed up rivers.
I worry about our water management sometimes. It gives me tired head thinking about it. Because then all those people can argue about, hey, you guys are damming up, keeping up too much water upstream. Oh, we need some down here.
Yeah.
Yet the Mississippi, you don't make any lakes off of that?
Too big.
Tuesday.
It's too big.
Tuesday's
the answer.
Too
powerful.
I think Craig's answer actually made a little more sense.
Yeah, I wish we knew.
But Pauly Shore, friend of this program, is going to play Richard Simmons in a new biopic.
Perfect.
Yeah.
That'd be funny.
Kind of looks like him when you see him with the... I don't have the picture here, but they showed a picture of Pauly Shore in the Richard Simmons outfit, and he looked like him. He's in a short film starring as Richard Simmons, and they're going to make it, I guess, into a longer movie. Oh, no, it says it's an unrelated short film about Richard Simmons that Pauly was in. Now he's going to be in another one about Richard Simmons, a full-length one. Is it going to say, hey, buddy?
Ooh,
I still think he's one of the better guests that we have on this program. Every time he comes in studio, he always shocks me with, I'm like, wow, man, you're saying way too much. You probably keep some of this close to the vest.
I hadn't had him in a long time.
I know. There was some conflict with him and Fernando.
Yeah.
That Fernando never would fully explain. It was always a little bit odd.
I think it was a Corby Kevin Spacey thing.
That's what Fernando claimed?
Yeah. Isn't that weird?
He just said that he invaded his space, I think.
All right. Anyway, on to other things. George, I promised you the story of the eunuch maker.
Oh, yeah. Yesterday.
Craig, I have a job for you.
Okay.
You have your red flag counter over there?
I do.
I want that job.
A male...
One.
Why? A male escort...
Two.
Who cut...
Three.
Off...
Four.
A consenting...
Five.
Man's...
Six.
Genitals...
Seven.
And filmed the procedure... For a pay-per-view website.
Nine.
Has been jailed
10.
For 5 years.
Wow.
Damian Burns removed Marius Gustafson's penis and testicles with a kitchen knife.
Are you sure, man?
Yeah, just do it. Just do it. Why do you have a playlist already to go
there?
I'm
trying to help
the show. Man, just do it. Just do it. I want him off.
See, he's mad because he didn't get to do it first.
I want him off right now. Please, God. Relieve me my sins.
I like your play better.
Removed it with a kitchen knife February of 2017. Damien, the remover, along with Jacob Krimi Appleby.
What a name.
And Nathaniel Arnold pleaded guilty to causing grave bodily harm with intent. Krimi Appleby...
No way.
Froze Gustafson's leg in dry ice, leading to its amputation. So, I guess they not only removed... Damien removed the guy's penis and testicles, while Krimi Appleby removed the guy's leg.
And this guy was consenting.
Yes. He wanted this done.
Why?
Some people have a thing where
they want
body
parts
amputated.
Off. We're so dumb.
What the hell is going on?
No, George, we should empower them to do this.
No,
this is their choice. Their body.
Good chance they're going to die.
And their choice. Well, it's because we don't make it legal, we force them to do these alternate procedures. We should allow doctors, if someone wants to voluntarily get their leg removed or their testicles removed, they should be able to go to a hospital and get it done, shouldn't they?
I guess, yeah, let's waste some more time for doctors and nurses who are overworked already. Let's just keep, go lop stuff off of people who don't need it.
That is not a medical way of wording it. It's not lopping stuff off. It's surgically removing it. While the third guy, Nathaniel Arnold, he had a different surgery he was performing on Gustafson. He partially removed the guy's nipple.
Okay.
So this guy wanted his penis, testicles, one of his legs, and part of his nipple removed.
Wow.
So he could feel whole again. I guess these things were detracting from him. Damien is linked to a subculture where men become nullos.
Oh, my God.
What does that stand for?
Genital nullification.
Oh, gosh.
God.
Why can't we just be thankful that we're here and that we're healthy? And why do we want to put in wild cards?
Okay.
You may
Here's
lose
George
a finger
once
in
again.
Some sort of accident.
However you're born, you just need to be happy with that.
You may lose your leg in a car accident or a motorcycle accident. Why do you have to do it to yourself?
If you don't want it, then
why would you
why
not
should
want
you be required
leg?
To carry
why would you want
a leg
go
to full
leg
term? In? Sir?
We're done.
I mean, I hear it sounds weird
you
to you and
we
me,
done,
right?
Because
we want our legs.
Contest.
But
you thought that was the end of society.
The birth contest was worse than becoming a nullo.
No, it's not.
I'm just saying nullos.
Everyone thinks a good loud burp is funny.
All right, we got Troy coming up. We got to go.
Well, will you ask Troy about nullos?
No.
No, we're not going to waste his time.
Birthdays today on sports. Tom Bailey. Won't you come home, Tom Bailey? The keyboardist for the Thompson Twins is 70. Kevin Costner is 69.
Oh, all right. Yeah, I need to call him.
Tickets
today.
Own Joy. Kevin Costner. Dave Attell, the comedian, is 59. Hunter Doohan is 30. He's on. He's an actor on Wednesday. I mean, not on Wednesday the day, but on the show. Mark Messier, 63. Brady Anderson, 60. Julius Peppers, 44. Angelique Kerber is 36. Leonard Fournette is 29. And T. Higgins is 27.
All right. Thank you. That is Muse. But let's open the door to the studio right now and welcome in Dr. Carlton Maxwell. He is our sports psychologist, teaches psychology at the University of Texas at Dallas. It opened. It opened, Dr. Maxwell, yes. And we have him on from time to time to talk sports psychology. Good morning.
Good morning. Let me have a mini coffee, shall we?
Okay. I have that coffee. Why does it have to be so well liked? Oh, that is just way too loud.
So wonderful. Good morning, George. And first to sing good morning, George. Well, I heard you fellers talking about spirit psychology.
Yes.
You know, and I know that a lot of people are curious about it. Spirit psychology is a widely respected growing division of psychology. I don't know if a lot of people know this, but spirit psychology was defined by the European Federation of Spirit Psychology as being the study of the psychological basis, processes, and effects of spirits.
Okay.
Sports?
Figured now, that out.
What does that mean? That means that I've wasted 13 seconds of your time saying those words, basically. The birth of sports psychology, you'll be interested to know, finds its origin in Europe. Largely in Germany is where it came from in the 1920s, which makes everyone a little bit nervous when you get around that time and, you know, trying to develop super athletes and all that. But that is where it started, in the 1920s in Germany. But it was really perfected by me in my sports lab at UTD in the 90s.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yes. I have worked with over 7,000 athletes.
7,000?
From David Hultz to Rusty Greer. I mean, the whole gamut.
Well, those are both Rangers outfielders.
Concentrate on keeping the mind-body connection connected.
Okay.
I maintain the integrity of that connection. Now, I do that by delivering performance-level psychology while giving full body massages. And it works. Oh, my God, it works.
Well, you want to be
relaxed.
That's
the thing.
I can see, yeah.
That's the thing. Yes, you got to get them very relaxed. They need to fully release all of the tension in their body.
Right.
To become a winner and remain one is very difficult, but that is my job as spirit psychologist. So on this very day, when the Cowboys needed to muse.
The muse.
I am offering my services to the Dallas Cowboys at a 30% discount.
Wow, it's very nice.
Giving them a deal, too.
30% discount for the first month. So,
just the first month.
I think that this is something that Jerry needs. Jerry wants to find every competitive edge. He needs my spirit psychology.
Okay, sounds good to me.
Now then, I also, in addition to my burgeoning practice of psychology, I also have some books.
Oh, yes, some books.
He's a noted author. Dr. Maxwell has written or co-authored over 4,400 books.
4,700 books. Sir!
Sorry.
4,700.
Sorry.
I've got some books for you. This one's
some
called.
Of them are shirt stories.
The. Wait.
What?
Short stories.
You said it weird.
Okay, sorry.
Okay. this one is called The Ooms A. Defense. Will we ever get the D back in Dallas by Dan Quinn?
Why would he write that book?
I don't know, but he did. And the drawings are done by Jerry Jr. So you get a little bit of that.
Right,
they're very rudimentary
bonus.
Kind of cave art looking drawing, but they're very good. Very good.
Okay.
This one is called Why I Will Never Give Up This GM-ship Because I Have an Ego Bigger Than My Bulbous Eyes by Jerry Jones. It's a very... Wow. Odd book for him to write. I think he wrote it while he was drunk.
Did he approve that title?
Somehow he did. You know, a lot of people are wondering, what is Dick supposed to do this offseason?
Who?
What, Dick! Dick!
Dak?
Dick?
Yes! Dick Prescott!
Who is Dick Prescott?
No! Not Dick! Dick!
Dak Prescott.
Yes, that's okay. What I'm saying, you fool.
Okay, sorry.
So this is what I recommend for Dick. And, you know,
see,
this is something, this is free of charge. I'm giving this, and I normally would charge for this, but I recommend to Dick to get a friend of his during this off season, mm-hmm. and every day I want him to go out and role play with this friend.
Okay.
I want this friend to pick off a pass from Dick every single day.
Okay.
So, and this is to teach Dick not to get so down on himself for throwing interceptions. See, I think that's what's happened here. I think what happens is when he throws an interception, it gets in his head, and he wills the next 12 interceptions because of that first one.
So every day, if he gets used to it, someone pick it off.
Yes, someone pick it off and return it for a pick six. And then,
that seems a little much, but okay.
And Dick gets used to this, and it doesn't make him will the next interception.
Okay.
You know, it doesn't affect him so much. Yes. Okay. Role playing is so important for these athletes. In fact, let's do a little role playing here. George, you play, let's say, a ranch hand with a secret, and I'll play your disciplinarian boss on the ranch.
Okay, I don't know where you're going with that. I'll see how that helps.
Okay, all right, we'll move on. That's fine. We'll move on. I got another pick for you here. This one's called Finally Giving Jerry Another Role Ring by Mike McCarthy. It's currently undergoing massive revisions. It was due to come out here in just a month or two.
Oh, he pre-wrote it?
Yes, and we're seeing if we can salvage some of the text in here now.
That seems like a jinx to write that book.
Give you each a copy of this because it's not going to be on the shelves.
Sure.
So okay, use it for it. Yes. Yeah. This, I got a firmer Kirby.
A what?
It's like Norwegian.
We need subtitles.
I'm from Tyler, Texas, sir.
Okay.
You were born in Tyler?
Yes. Not Norwegian. I hired a firmer Kirby to write a book that I will personally deliver to Dak. Now, this is the first time that you're doing to me to your career. In an entire career, I've never hired someone to write a book for just one particular reader, but okay. I did in this case. Mm-hmm. This book, and I'm just showing it to you. I can't give you a copy because there's only one of these.
Okay.
And I'm giving it to Dick Prescott. It's called Don't Become Another Me by Tony Romo. It's a one-off book.
I'll take a
one-off book
written for one person.
Dick Prescott and Dick Prescott only. This is any fans of defense around here?
Sure. I love defense.
All right. This is called F It Happened Again by DeMarcus Lawrence.
But it's spelled out.
Yes,
there,
it's spelled out. You can see. I'm cleaning it up.
Thank you for cleaning it up.
Thank you for doing that.
This one's called I Couldn't Even Win There by Bill Belichick. This is,
he's tipping
his hand on this one. But yeah. And this is, here's another one by another famous coach. It's called Why Me and 500 Other Coaches Don't Want That Job by Jim Harbaugh. So there's just a few.
Boy, there's a lot to read.
Wow,
there.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Go Cowboys.
Dr. Carlton.
Why didn't the door close?
It closed, Dr. Maxwell.
What are you doing back in here? 8:49 on the ticket.
Thank you, Craig. It is Thursday, and oh, there's the door. I just came in. Today's Thursday, and Thursday means it's Twitch night as it moves back to its regular time, 7:35 p.m. If you'd like to join me for our P1 Twitch hangout, it's twitch.tv/actualgordonkeith, and I usually bug some of the other ticket hosts, and tonight I'm going to bug one George Dunham.
I don't know if I'm
to home. Get a look at hopefully your bird dog. I have bird dog questions because I'm considering getting a bird dog.
Are you really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, and you have
like a high energy
one in Gunner
or
no? I like the labs.
Yeah. You mean a Labrador Retriever, a big believer?
Is that the end of his song?
That's just a little bit one of his cheers.
Okay. Oh, it's a cheer, not a song. Sorry.
You know, I'm a little offended that you've never bugged me.
Would you like me to? I figured you don't answer my calls or texts, so I just figured you wouldn't answer a
I thought you were staying away
call.
From me because we have a small child.
You had a kid? I haven't been keeping up with your life. You didn't tell me that.
You can call me anytime.
Okay.
Now, I may not answer, but you've never even tried.
Gosh.
At least give me the chance to not answer.
At least give you the chance to disappoint me?
I've used that line with women my whole life. Please give me the chance to disappoint you. It's night, 7:35 p.m. All right, Charles. He says, Cooper Rush, put him in after the first Dak interception. Cowboys would win the Super Bowl. This Dak worship is dead forever. Enough already. He's not a champion. The locker room must be a mess. Well, good Lord, you packed a lot of overreactions into that one email.
Super Bowl!
Could you imagine the controversy if the first pick that Dak throws, they'd yank him out of the game and put in Cooper Rush?
Oh, my gosh.
And Dak has one more year on his deal?
Mm-hmm. About to be two or three, probably.
Yeah. They'll renegotiate this offseason?
I think so.
They will extend him, probably, yes.
Okay. Stephanie emails and says, good morning, Gordon. It's me, P1 Stephanie from Keller. Sounds like the Zodiac speaking.
A little bit.
It's me. She says that Jerry Jones, she's a longtime educator, Stephanie is, and she says Jerry Jones makes her think of helicopter parents. She says he's a helicopter GM. He can't get out of his own way. He absolutely can't let his child, the team, grow on its own. He suffocates it by constantly interfering with his own agenda, micromanaging where he doesn't need to micromanage, being oddly hands-off when sometimes he should be, paying attention to football. He says, I've seen these kinds of parents. She says, I've seen these kinds of parents, of course, in her career. And he won't let the coaching staff, the teachers, do their job. The analogy is the helicopter parent doesn't let the teacher do their job. They get involved.
Great analogy.
Yeah. She says, I just wanted to share it with you, my favorite muser. But I also love George and non-George so much. Much love, Stephanie. And she signs it with XOXOXO.
Ooh, I think she likes you.
Yeah. I know.
Didn't that always thrill you as a boy whenever a girl would sign? It could be the most innocuous note whatsoever, and she just puts the X's and O's up under it. Yeah. And you're always like, oh,
kind of like that. Got a chance. Okay. Yeah.
It's amazing how starved for female attention young men were back in the day. I don't know if boys today still encounter this.
I think they're too worried about video games.
Okay, boomer.
Okay. You looking in the mirror?
Video games are pretty awesome.
They're amazing.
I still need to get back into Red Dead Redemption 2. But I found
that a couple times and I got kind of bored with it, so I just shot up every bar I went into.
Gosh. You just went full evil in it?
Yeah.
What's wrong with you?
I don't know.
JQ says, Gordon, I'd like to very gracefully and humbly bring it to your attention that Lake Sam Rayburn in East Texas is larger than Texoma. I hope my pointing this out doesn't hurt your most vulnerable feelings or impact your confidence
in
any way.
Thank you for knowing, Gordo. That's
Thanks for all you do, even when you might not quite get it right.
Sam Rayburn's bigger than
Yeah, I've always thought Texoma. That Texoma was the biggest, but when I looked up a list of the five biggest lakes in Texas.
Wow, it's huge.
When I looked up five biggest lakes in Texas, Texoma ranked fourth. It's not even second. It's fourth.
Okay.
Can you name the three that are bigger?
White Rock?
No.
Okay, Craig has obviously... This is why I don't call you on Twitch nights.
Bachman?
Is because I know that you won't take it seriously.
Lake Louisville is huge.
Not on the top five.
Not on the top five.
Now, I'm looking at a map, and compared to Sam Rayburn, you could fit four Lake Louisvilles in Sam Rayburn.
Darn.
Not quite. Two and a half, probably. Lake Texoma is 78,000 acres. Sam Rayburn is, Sam Rayburn, it's not even double the size, is 112,000 acres. So
I've
that map is
that
misleading, but still, it's considerably bigger.
Can I guess?
Yeah, you can guess. I would have gotten neither of these. I don't even know that I knew these.
Is Lake Livingston on there?
No. That's number nine
okay.
on the list.
Number nine?
That's 32,000 acres.
What is this? Looks like it's in Louisiana, maybe. Sabine? What is this? I can't find the name of this lake.
Number five on the top five biggest lakes in Texas, Lake Amistad.
Okay.
It's 66,000 acres.
I didn't know it was that big.
Then Texoma.
Where's that?
That's up northwest of Fort Worth. It's even further up than PK.
Then Texoma at 78,000 acres. Then Falcon Reservoir at 85,000 acres.
Where'd that?
I don't know. Like I said, I didn't even hear of some of these. Then Sam Rayburn, 112,000 acres. And then number one in Texas is the Toledo Bend Reservoir, 182,000 acres. So that is considerably bigger than even number two on the list. It's almost another Texoma bigger than Sam Rayburn. Toledo Bend Reservoir, or Toledo. I don't know how you say it in this case.
Oh, yeah. That's the one I was looking at on the map. It's right on the border of Texas and Louisiana, all through that national forest.
Mm-hmm.
It's huge.
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 Other notables on this, Lake Livingston was number nine, 32,000 acres. 17 was Caddo Lake, 26,000 acres. 18, Lake Ray Hubbard, 20,000, almost 21,000 acres. Lake Travis at 22, Canyon Lake at 46.
Wow, just a few other ones. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, Amistad is down south. I was thinking of another lake up.
Yeah, I thought you were wrong, and I'm like, what? And you're like, hey.
Someone yells at me.
Amistad's on the U.S.-Mexican border.
Yeah.
And then the stat that I gave, which I've always thought was true, was that Caddo Lake was the only natural lake in Texas, and that's mm-hmm. not true.
Huh.
According to a Texas Monthly article that came out in 2019, said that Caddo Lake says that there are plenty of natural lakes in Texas, and Caddo Lake arguably is not even one of them. It's not even a natural lake in one sense, because it was created by a big log jam that started getting clogged up along the Red River. And it grew, this log jam grew and got bigger and flooded the Big Cypress Bayou. And then when they got the log jam unclogged, it started draining, and they said, you know what, we kind of like this lake, and so then they kind of dammed it up to keep some of it in there.
They had to dam that up,
yeah.
Too, huh?
And so it started, you know, in a way, it just wasn't always there. It was created by this log jam that happened.
Okay.
So it's arguable whether that's natural or not. But it says that, yeah, there's a lot of lakes in Texas. They're just smaller lakes. We don't think of them as big lakes.
Okay.
And, you know, it's crazy. But when I moved here, I couldn't comprehend the size of these lakes that were here. Like, that didn't make sense to my brain, because my grandparents lived on a lake, and it was a 220-acre lake, I think it was. It was around 200-acre lake. I thought that's what lakes were, 200 acres.
Yeah.
And then I come here, and I start seeing these 78,000 acres, and I was like, that's an ocean to me.
Yeah.
And then, after seeing Texoma and things like this, going up there, and when we saw the Great Lakes,
oh yeah. My gosh.
That boggles my mind.
I know, me too.
Okay, finally, would you wait for this, Giorgio? As tonight, when I try to hopefully successfully contact you on Twitch and talk about dogs, you've had a dog that's eaten did something that it shouldn't have.
Yes.
Multiple times.
The late, great Bo Jackson, Basset Hound.
And I believe one of those caused his death, ultimately led to his death. He ate something that...
and as it turned out, he was trying to... Some dog owners say you shouldn't put a collar on him.
Mm-hmm.
His collar got caught on a bush, and he had to eat his way out.
And he swallowed some of the...
And he got a sticker. He got a thorn.
Oh.
Yeah, in his intestines.
But he also ate an army man. I remember that
once.
Yeah,
he did do that. They were strung together. That was, you know... that was dramatic.
Strung together?
Yeah,
oh wait, so this came out like beads?
Yeah.
Like,
well, they had to do surgery.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Well, a Pennsylvania couple, they left $4,000 in cash on their countertop. And they had a golden doodle, their 7-year-old golden doodle, grabbed it off the countertop and started chewing on it and ate quite a bit of the money.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
Now, this is cash. So they shouted at him. They got him to stop eating. They're fishing some out of his mouth, but he had consumed quite a bit of them. So then they went through and they documented the painstaking process of trying to salvage as much money as they could.
But it's shredded, though, isn't it?
By taping together the ones that he had shredded with his teeth. And then, of course, also waiting and capturing all of his mounds of evil.
I hope if he chewed up hundreds that he put out tens and twenties.
Okay. You think like a cartoon. So after all that, they were able to tape together and wash, because they also had to throw it in the laundry and wash all the evil off of it, $3,550 of it.
Oh, okay.
So they even talked to the bank and said, hey, look, here's our situation. If we bring this money in, can we exchange it for decent bills? Will this still be considered legal tender? And they said, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. If you tape it back together and you have most of the pieces, what's the rule? Is it's got to have the serial number, I think.
Yeah.
Has to be intact, and you can exchange it for full bills.
I hope the dog helped him put it back together.
What do you mean?
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do it.
Man, all right, this matches. I just did not think. Does this match with that? And he's no good at doing the puzzle at all. It's like clearly it doesn't match. Does not fit with this other piece.
Slide a piece of doo-doo. I'm just trying to help the five. You, man. Yeah.
What? There you go.
All right, Gordo. Thank you.
Get the Steak Podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Oh, yeah. It is our postseason follow-up to Picks with Friends. Season done. I'm the loser. We'll pick a date to where I have to be a Nowitzki Way player for an hour during every single show on that day. And we have gathered our friends for this postseason press conference. We've gathered the reporters to get the questions asked, to see how we feel about this season and what we look forward to next season. So, Matt, Mino in studio. We need the Bob.
Yeah.
We need the Corby.
Hello.
And we need the Jub.
Got me right here.
All here, ready to rock and roll. First question. I guess we just need to talk to the winner of Picks with Friends. How did you feel about the season there, Corby?
You know, Donovan, I don't like to brag. It's setting records is fun, but really it's about me more than anything. Just my prowess in this contest of winning 3 out of 4 years now. One minor hiccup last year, of course, but it's just an honor to play with you guys. You know, you bring out the best in me, and I think that's what's most important, our friendship through the years.
92-58, Corby wound up betting in 150 games this year. 92 wins. Better than second place Mino, who was 83-67 in his rookie year. Mino, how did you feel about your rookie year of Picks with Friends?
I'll accept the Rookie of the Year award in Picks with Friends this year. We didn't get to where we wanted to be on top. We really just want to take down Corby next season. That's the main goal.
That's the important thing.
Because the biggest thing is if you're not last, you're first in Picks with Friends, Donovan.
Yeah, I wouldn't know anything about that.
But I had a pretty strong start, just wanted to not completely fall late in the season. Because we all had a good year. We were all over 500, right?
Yes, we were. 10 games over 500 for last place, 80-70. But tied for third place was Matt and Jubb at 82-68. Matt, rookie year.
Promising for the future, I thought. I was real pleased with our efforts this year, and all I can say is that I did come here to win a championship, so buy in to us.
Moose?
I'm just glad that hung on to the very end, and I'm not paying somebody off for the third time in 4 years.
In fifth place this year at 81-69, yeah,
Bob Stern. Bob.
Hey, Dad.
Hey, Dad. I don't know if it's fifth place. I mean,
it is.
I was watching Monday Night Football stress-free, and three guys were still in it. So I think I was on the podium, but it's there's no real truth anymore. It's all subjective. So I have given myself third place. Thank you.
Well, no, it's not subjective. You were 81-69 in fifth place.
In your opinion.
And in last, 80-70. You know what? This may be the best record I've ever had in Picks with Friends. I think it is. 80 wins and I'm in last place. Oh, God. All I have to say is, to hell with the Steelers and to hell with the Eagles for losing on Monday night. I gave it everything I had.
It was a good pick.
Pennsylvania killed you.
Yeah, and it wasn't good enough. So I'm never going to Pennsylvania again.
We're back to Pittsburgh.
Now we have to see what the heck I'm going to do out in the plaza. But Corby, as the winner, you had an interesting thought and suggestion for next year's Picks with Friends. So why don't you take the floor?
Yeah, George, see if you agree with this. And I talked with Matt and Donnie about it. And Bob and I actually kicked this around the other night on our remote. And that is, and this has nothing to do with me winning.
A pillow talk?
Trust me. Yeah, a little pillow talk. But it seems like we're really not doing anything for the people that succeed in this. Like, this is just a loser's bracket. And what about, or if we take the European soccer stance of promotion and relegation, where the winner gets eliminated from having to compete the next year, and we welcome in a new competitor, i.e. Sean or Craig or Dave Lane.
Deddy.
Gordon.
Never do
yes.
it.
Yes.
Dan Bennett.
Gordon would win 100 games in Picks with Friends.
He probably would.
Well, that'd be great.
He'd go 150.
Yeah, he would forget to do it every week.
He'd just dominate.
Like 80 games under 500 because he'd forget to fill it out.
That's true. But yeah, like we reward
maybe Mark
the winner. And the winner gets to pick the punishment. Like there's the winner gets something other than just to say he won.
I think
it would serve a year as a commissioner. And so you're still involved. There are rulings. There are thoughts.
You're on with Picks with Friends every week. You're involved.
And then you hand the baton to next year's winner, and then they are promoted. I like this idea. I think there's something to it.
Yeah, I do too.
Interesting.
Unless you want the fifth place idea.
Game of soccer, but okay.
Or how about if you lose and you're in last place, you're out. You can't lose again next year. Hey! No. I feel good about that.
I think you still have to play next year.
What? Yeah. But I'm the loser. Who wants the loser?
Well, we want to give you a chance to put a streak together.
Yeah, just win it all next year and move out.
No, I like that idea. For that person to be the commissioner, they're the overseer. So any issues that we have, any questions, any rulings that need to be made, it's someone that doesn't affect.
So are we saying exactly. Corby is out next year, or this goes into effect next season?
He's the commissioner next year, and we bring in another team to play
maybe
Picks
Corby,
with Friends.
Maybe Corby has to pick his successor. I'm fine with making this effective immediately. I think we've needed a first place boost for some time, and Corby's just so good at picking games. This will give the rest of us a chance to win.
It's like when Jordan
went to play baseball. Suddenly the Rockets get
Jordan
a chance.
Now? Are you kidding me? Yeah, just call me Olajuwon. I'm going to win when Corby. I can't win because Corby's in it. That's what it is. I'm down with that if everyone else is. I'm happy to hand over the reins to the commissioner so he can be the ultimate judge and jury about all the questions that we have. And maybe he has some rules that need to be in effect for Picks with Friends next year. It's all about the commissioner. He's the Goodell of Picks with Friends.
I like that.
I love the fact that whoever does win, their toes are still dipped squarely into the pool that is Picks with Friends. It's not like they walk away from things. They're still a voice every single week. It's just a reward for a successful season.
And then you come back the next year, and then the winner of Picks with Friends will take their place on the commissioner's court.
Yes.
I like it.
Okay.
Yes. I vote yes. All in favor?
Yes.
Yay.
Ooh, I'd like to haunt the picks next year.
First off, I do want to say, as commissioner next year, there will be a dress code because I have had it with you guys.
Are you going to do anything about people picking the same triple play, or does that matter?
We'll see. We'll see. We have a whole off season. I'm going to meet with the competition committee probably in early March. We're going to go to Tulum and have a weekend together, and then we'll just go from there.
In the hot tub. Go to Cabo. It worked well for one other team. Yeah, okay.
That team sucks.
Okay, so let me ask you this, Donovan.
Yes.
Because we didn't really square this away. So when you perform, it's an hour for each show, but obviously you're not going to do like an hour. It's not like a TV episode where you're doing an hour straight. So like for our show, if we wanted you, like we have three ideas for three different hours. It'll each take 5 to 10 minutes or something like that. Is that cool?
Sure.
So we can separate it how we want. Because the sweet spot, we've got our idea already. And if you want to go an hour, I think it would be better that way. Okay. I'm not going to tell you what it is, but or we could break it up into two 30-minute spots or 20s.
Well, I think after our show is kind of wide open. It was just the before because I still have to do our show, so maybe not the entire morning for the musers, or maybe we wait until the sun comes up. So for the musers, it may have to be an hour straight. But everyone else, I think if you break it up, that's fine. Because I'll be done with working.
Okay.
Is that cool?
Yeah, we'll work with that. Yep.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
Have we picked a date?
No,
we have not. No.
I mean, we need to pick a day that is inconsequential in the world of sport where maybe, and Bob even mentioned this, maybe do it on a night when the Mavs play at home. That way people are starting to stream in. Yeah.
Love that.
Or the Stars. That, Mavs or Stars.
That sounds ridiculous.
Bring back.
I don't think that should be the case. I think we should do it on a non-sports day. So we could, not even interrupt anything with mindless stuff that's going on out in the plaza.
Maybe it's time to bring back Speedo Dunk Tank just to see how that would go on the plaza.
Ooh, yeah. Night. Okay.
Yeah. You could do that if you chose.
Well, the whole swimming thing,
You're not swimming in a dunk tank. We're afraid. It's like 3 feet of water.
No, you have to. I won't be able to stand up. What if I blow my knee out and I can't stand up?
It's ridiculous.
What if I blow my knee out?
That doesn't bother me, Moose.
It's going to be great.
I have so been waiting for this, though, after all the triple play hell you've put us all through with your ridiculous teams that you choose. This is such...
Finally caught up with you.
Yep, it did.
It'll be interesting to see if he changes his offense now.
Just because I went Eastern Michigan doesn't mean that's the reason that I lost.
Mm-hmm. Is the game passed him by?
I went 80-70. It's the best record I've ever had.
That's a really good record, man. It just wasn't good enough.
It wasn't good enough.
You're like the Cowboys. You had a great regular season, but when you needed it, you failed.
I know.
I mean, we scored 32 points in the playoff game.
We did.
Wasn't that good?
Look at that. Look at it.
You failed.
Look at it. All right. So the next step is picking a date, and then we can put the plan in action.
So let's shoot for like March when it warms up a little bit. That way it'll be, we won't be miserable out there, and people can come out and watch, and they won't be miserable either. Like, let's pick a nice day where the weather turns and we're all happy.
I love it.
I'm in. Do it. You guys are great.
Wow.
You champions.
See how you turn it around? See how that works, Moose?
I know. It's not fun. I'm sorry.
All right, fellas. Thank you for the... I accept your apology, and I'm sorry also. Therefore, I just don't have to do this. All right. Thank you. Thank you for the postseason press conference. We appreciate it, friends. Love you. We'll pick a date. We'll let everyone know. And then it is Nowitzki Way player Donnie Dew in full effect. All right, boys.
Yep.
Thank you, guys, kindly.
Thank
That's
you,
our
George.
Friends.
Bye, George.
No more picking.
Bye, Corby.
It's all about performing.
Bye, Bob.
All right.
It's 2:16 on a Thursday, so we slide into the DMs, and Justin sends news.
Hey, Monty, send news.
You don't have Provolone Joe, but you have Meatball Monty.
Meatball
Happy
Monty.
To be here.
I love our meatball hoagie.
As the only man to ever eat a meatball mid-news on the station.
Huh.
I'll gladly wear that title.
Mid-segment, right? Like,
yeah.
Not in a break, just...
Right in the middle of the news being delivered. Right in the middle of some apartment fire in Euless.
Sometimes that food's just calling.
I would destroy a meatball sub right now. I'm starving.
It wasn't even a sub. It was just a meatball that I stabbed and brought to my mouth.
Yeah, write it down, bitch.
At least you used utensils. You didn't just barehand that bad boy.
No, just have sauce all over my hands. No. I ate the meatball like a gentleman. Well, the scuttlebutt around Dallas right now is that AT&T Stadium appears to possibly, maybe... host the 2026 FIFA World Cup final, which immediately makes people think, is that what Jerry's been doing for the last couple of weeks? Is worrying about getting the World Cup final here?
Yeah,
which, well, in a vacuum would be pretty cool.
Yeah, we're going to be excited for that in 2026.
You think Peter Welton's got his
beach
towel?
Oh my gosh.
Out.
Oh my god, his pants are just flying around right now.
His timeline is just soccer and
just calling
stuff.
Gordon Jago, whoever he wants.
Ronaldo.
Yeah, Messi. But apparently this is according to the British tabloid The Sun, the Cowboys Stadium beat out MetLife Stadium in Jersey, home of the New York Giants and the Jets, to get the championship honors. Also, Arlington appears to have beat out Miami and New York to serve as the, quote, main base for the festivities. This will begin in June 2026. So it's not technically official, but the rumors are that the Cowboys actually won something.
And Dallas is going to have to raise the turf, right? They're going to have to, like, elevate.
There are going to have to be, yeah, some modifications to the field.
Yeah.
Are those going to be permanent, or is that just a...
Just have RoboTurf?
Yeah, they're going to put Minute Maid rays out there in center field.
Well, the Rangers mound can lower robotically. Why not just do that with an entire football
field? Yeah,
we can
lower a pitcher's mound. We can do anything.
That's cool.
What?
Yeah. I didn't know that.
You didn't know about this?
No.
Yeah, when they want to put a Green Day concert or whatever out at the new ballpark, they just lower it and they put tile down and people can...
Whoa.
Yeah, the pitcher's mound. It's on an elevator.
Festival. Yeah.
Has it ever accidentally just lowered?
Yeah, I'd like
mid,
to, I'd
mid
like
inning,
to, like in the middle of Framber Valdez throwing a pitch, just raise like, it 10 feet.
You just got Tony Beasley with like a giant remote.
Yeah, some,
and it just starts spinning.
Childish Inspector Gadget right. 2-button remote that raises it 10 feet in the air.
Go Gadget pitcher's mound.
Yeah, I just want it to start spinning like the, what was that thing on Battle Dome? Do you ever watch that show? It was like the American Gladiator spinoff.
I think you're on a...
Dude!
Pal.
Nobody? Nobody watched American Battle Gladiator, Dome in the late 90s? Are you serious? That thing was awesome.
Cable. Battle Bots, yes.
Oh, Battle Dome.
Say, Battle Bots was where it's at.
I'll show you some episodes of Battle Dome. Change your life.
Mark.
Team Money was in it.
Are you threatening me?
Terry Crews was in it. Young Terry Crews.
All right, now you're selling me.
You'll enjoy yourself.
All right, so yeah, be ready for that. Get your mind ready for 2.5 years from now, the World Cup final here. Maybe get old USA playing at home.
All right.
We'll be watching like Argentina and Germany or something. That's how it goes.
Is Ronaldo's kid eligible to play yet? Because I remember he had a...
RJ?
Ronaldo Jr.?
I don't know. He's probably got
he's
a
American.
Lot of old bastards in every city in the world. I have no idea. We'll look it up. We'll call Peter. See what he has to say. So we have another plane story, another wild-ass plane story, as an American airline passenger, not American Airlines, but an airline passenger.
Mm-hmm. Who is American.
Who is American. Was flying from Nippon, Japan... to Seattle.
I know Nippon because of baseball.
Yeah. they're flying home Tuesday whenever this person got drunk and started biting the crew.
Like kind of lovingly biting or aggressively biting?
I don't know if there's lovingly fighting if you're not.
Show me a loving bite to Mino so I kind of get an
idea.
It's
like a little nibble on his neck.
Yeah, yeah, like, a little ear.
Mine, what you?
The earlobe.
Yeah.
Go a little harder. A
little goosebumps start poking out.
Go a little more.
Yeah, I don't hear the safe word yet. But no, so this was a male passenger.
Safe word is John Burkett.
That started biting female flight attendants, and they had to turn the plane back around, or he was arrested by Japanese authorities.
I worry about that stuff now. Not the biting, but just someone losing their mind on a flight because of social media.
Are we on the same flight to Vegas?
Yeah, we will be.
So we have to be
on the
lookout.
You should
bite Mino. Huh?
We need to, like, be like fake air marshals. Or I'll just nibble on you. That's fine. See what happens.
That can't be worse than the girl that threw up next to you.
Nothing can be worse than the girl that threw up next to me. Worst moment of my life.
Cowboys trip?
Yeah, that was the Green Bay trip last year. I had a window seat. Girl was in the middle seat and just... not in the bag. Just all over herself.
Was she throwing up Wolf Brand chili?
I don't...
Cheese curds.
I don't remember what it looked like, but I remember what it smelled like. And it was bad. Almost as worse as the kid that said, "What happened to me?" The little 10-year-old that I wanted to punch in the face. And I'm still mad at.
You know, he's having a good week.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Wasn't that guy special needs?
No. Well, the kid online was, but this is a different kid.
Oh.
Mino's beefing with a lot of kids.
I was like, wait a minute. All right, just
F
making
them
sure.
Kids.
Apparently, this is not the first case of a midair biting. A couple of years ago, someone bit people on a flight between American Airlines and Delta, and they were fined $90,000. So this may be
so it's not worth
bite.
It.
No,
never. Even if it is loving and caring, it's not worth
the fine is cheaper to smoke on an airplane than it is to bite somebody.
Right. A couple
it's only
of
like 2,000.
Got a smoke. Couple of wheels off criminals here. 42-year-old Jessica Beatty is currently out on parole.
Go away, Beatty.
She from Clearwater, Florida. She has a lengthy rap sheet, numerous cocaine convictions, been incarcerated multiple times. Well, she's out on parole, and part of the release terms were that she is subject to being urine tested randomly. Well, I guess she went out in late December, had a fun time, partied.
Yeah, end of the year.
We all do it.
Yeah. Just cut loose a little bit.
Maybe a company party.
Yeah, maybe do a little ice at the company party. Well, she knew that her urine would turn up dirty. So does she go the Lyle Collins route and bribe the test taker? No.
Maybe an original Wizinator.
Do they make female Wizinators? Like just
I'm
little
sure you just
tiny wieners.
It's a great question.
I'm sure you could just have it up by there and just squeeze it out.
What? Just like tape it?
Yeah.
You don't have look that up. Look that up, Lando. Look up
in
female
there.
Wizinator. Get back to us.
How do women pee?
That's not what she did, though. She went and got some clean urine. Seems smart. Problem is, she got it from her aunt's dog.
Oh.
Oh, no.
So she went and ran over to old Rocco and had him pee in a cup for her. And she was shocked when she found out that the medical office is able to easily differentiate human and non-human pee.
What are you looking at right now, Monty?
That can't be what a woman uses.
It says female right there.
Yeah, but that looks like it goes in, not out.
No.
It looks like a funnel and a dill were merged. That's not it. That's not what I'm talking about.
I think I see this picture too.
Yeah, we'll show you during the break what it looks like. It's
and to the
can't be what they use.
To her method of getting the dog urine.
Uh-huh.
Don't you think it would be easier to just get a relative?
Yes, trying to.
Well, how would you go about getting the dog you're in?
Yeah, you
would
have follow the dog around. Yeah. A bucket or something,
and then wait for it, and then just like quickly go underneath there, and feel like that would be really difficult to obtain.
Yeah. Ma'am, you have rabies.
Yeah, and heartworms.
You haven't been taking your heartworm medicine.
put
in a little piece of cheese so you don't know you're taking
it.
You want
some heart guard, ma'am.
Yeah, so she is going back to jail. Shocker. Hmm. Lastly, you know, the weather has been pretty crazy all over America.
Mm.
You may have looked outside and noticed.
Just wait 5 minutes.
Well, a man that was in Memphis prison this past weekend was able to escape. 20-year-old DeMarcus Davis, who according to you has a brother named DeMichael Davis.
No, but my theory is that Marcus's have brothers named Michael. There's a good chance of it.
Well, he escaped.
I'm going to distance from.
You know, did the Shawshank, I'm free. But then realized it was below zero outside. He lasted 1 hour and then called the police to come pick him back up.
I'm too cold.
He was like, it's too cold out here, dude. I didn't bring my prison issued parka with me. And so, yeah, he lasted 1 hour.
Like, yeah, can we just be cool? Like, I tried to do it, but then I thought better because it's cold. And
he couldn't cut open a tauntaun. Myself in. Yeah. Crawl inside.
And so now DeMarcus Davis charged with one count of escape and two counts of statutory rape.
Mm.
You're playing a lightsaber or something, Ham? Something funny?
I was looking at something Lando sent me.
That wasn't part of the escape,
was
though.
It the
that,
funnel-ween?
That was previous.
So, yeah, at least if you're going to escape prison, you know, don't be like a house cat and not know what your next move is going to be the second you walk outside.
Maybe don't be like the Cowboys in the playoffs.
You
know, because they don't know what to do in playoff games.
Yeah, we got it, Norm.
All right.
But that was good news, Justin.
Once again, the ticket presents Why Today Doesn't Suck.
Dude. You suck.
And now, here are your hosts, Sean Bass and David Mino.
I would destroy a meatball sub right now. I'm starving.
I guess that's a brag.
It's true.
That you could destroy a meatball sub. It's a sweet spot, Sean Bass, David Mino, and at 258, Ham.
Thank you, DM. GiveMeTheVin.com brings you Meatball Monty.
Thanks, Ham. Appreciate it. Is all your blood back?
We're back in business, boys.
Attaboy.
Blood's back.
They returned it.
He donated 33% of his blood yesterday to an allergy doctor. Now he's all good. Well, it is 2:58, like you said. We welcome in the hard line. Bob.
Corby.
Dave. How we doing?
Hello, Montobe.
Hi, Corby. All right,
bros.
I'm good.
Is that a good sandwich?
Really good.
Looks awesome.
Delicious.
My sandwich just fell apart.
It's not a meatball sub, though.
It's true.
If it was, Sean would be destroying it right now.
I'd jump over the table.
I thought about stopping off at like Potbelly and grabbing you one, but
damn.
I know. They're really good there.
Or just getting a giant one for yourself and eating it in front of them.
Right. Oh, I should have done that.
I got a party sub, but I'm really hungry.
Just pouring it on my head.
Throw it away.
Just slowly eating it.
I wish I could eat it, but I'm so full and just throw it in the trash.
Just sneeze on it.
Yeah, you just teabag throw it away.
That's what he does to the homeless guys.
Bob
35.
Threatened to teabag my beer the other day.
Definitely not what was threatened.
I dared him to dunk his wiener into your beer when you went away to the bathroom or something. To dunk it.
Hey, guys, watch this. Pencil D? How's that going to work?
In public.
This brew's been stirring.
Bob, what's happened to him?
Well, it was do Sturm Center, Bob.
It was a funny prank when we wait for him to take a drink and then tell him what happened.
Bob's penis was in there.
Gotcha.
Corby shrugs.
How's it taste, bitch?
Good IPA.
Yeah.
It's a little IPA. More skunky than normal.
That 8% will kill it. Don't worry about it. Oh, Bob, you're always putting your wing in stuff.
Well, we just thought the people at the stock show would look over there oddly at my behavior. So
old Wiener Sturm strikes again.
We decided not to.
As you're plunging a velvet hammer.
There was this bit in college. Just can't quit it.
He won't drink one.
Right.
But he'll put it in our level joke.
Well, today is Thursday, January 18th, the 18th day of 2024. Only 348 days left in the year. On this date in 1733, the first polar bear was exhibited in America in Boston. Pretty cool.
Where'd they get it?
Alive?
It doesn't say.
Wasn't
probably
it being,
Guinness.
Yeah, stuffed?
Wasn't it being shipped to Madagascar? And
the movie?
Just kind of fell off the boat. And
yeah, just floated to shore.
There's a polar bear here.
Cool.
I mean, in 1733, seeing a weird animal from a different part of the world, that was like witchcraft.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, but they were probably so excited to see a white bear that they were like, dude.
Finally.
Yeah, give
like
him,
us.
Yeah, they gave him land.
You could vote.
Yeah, they gave him a vote.
He's at a committee meeting.
Yeah, not you with the boobs.
Yeah, no. Get out of here, Grizzlies.
Male bear? Okay. We're good.
Here's Corby's beer.
No, it tastes fine. Don't worry about it. On this date, 1951, the NFL rules that tackles, guards, and centers are ineligible for forward passes.
Yeah, take that, Lions.
We need to change that back.
Yeah.
It would so be more fun if it was like flag football and everyone could catch a pass.
Yeah, why not?
Like six-man football.
Like, dude, Zach Martin ran a terrible out pattern.
The center's running the seam.
Yeah. How many slants would Mike McCarthy
that
run at the same
sweet,
depth?
Dude, get your center.
Let's have five
run
slants.
Run a go route. Yeah, that was a bad one. We need to fix that one. In 1958, hockey player Willie O'Ree of the Boston Bruins takes to the ice for a game against the Montreal Canadiens, becoming the first black player to play in the National Hockey League.
Oh, I know friend this of the guy. Show. That was black like the team. Opposite of the polar bear.
Yeah, can't vote.
Yeah, the other way around.
Whoa.
How many black players are currently in the NHL?
Let's see. One.
PK Subban is
he's
on
Daly
the
is,
desk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Four.
Four.
I'm going to say four.
Bob?
Lando?
I'd rather not play this game given the borderline designations
what?
Of some.
Oh.
And it's just, you know, it's tough to.
You
tough
tried
to
get me to come up with
out.
An all white NBA team.
I'm saying there's still quite a few.
It's a little okay. easier to identify.
Internet says there's 34 active.
Okay. I was right there.
Actively black?
Yeah.
Yeah, they filled out their card for 2024.
Seth Jones.
Yep.
Sure.
Popeye's kid.
Dallas' own.
Let's see. In 1975, the sitcom The Jeffersons, a spinoff from All in the Family, premiered on CBS.
No,
it's not that.
Not
consider the conversation
Martin.
We just had, Ham. And don't be a big jerk.
Is anybody alive from The Jeffersons?
You're a big jerk.
Just Wheezy, I think.
I
don't think she's alive.
In our hearts, she is.
True.
She died in 04. We're sad to report.
I hadn't kept up with her in like 20 years, so that makes sense. In 1983, Dick Motta becomes the fifth NBA coach to record 600 wins as his Dallas Mavericks defeat the Golden State Warriors.
Dick Motta. Yeah, we got him. I'm a Dallas Mavericks fan.
And then immediately the Mavericks released a statement saying he will be back for 1984.
I thought he was the greatest coach in the history of the league. In my little Mavericks head as a child.
Could he coach 8th grade North Garland right now?
But I couldn't figure out why he always was mad at Mark Aguirre. I was like, why Mark? He's so cool. Finger rolls and stuff.
I think Dick Motta was notoriously a hater of the finger rolls. That's why he hated Mark Aguirre. Let's see, in 1993, the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday was observed in all 50 states for the first time.
Those states were holding out.
Yeah.
Took them quite a while.
I don't think so.
They'd have been dead for 30 years.
What I mean, we can probably guess which states were holding out.
We're probably near some of them.
Right. It may be the one we're sitting in.
Monty.
Uh-huh.
What year?
93.
So this is Arizona, right?
No, they held out for daylight savings, Bob.
No. They held out for Martin Luther King.
Oh, they did?
Absolutely.
Why Arizona?
Why Arizona?
Yeah.
It's always Arizona. Right?
Weird.
It's a pretty wheels off
state. Is this a personal vendetta you have against Arizona?
No, it's called...
It says hate for Devin Booker.
The news. It happened. They didn't get to the... It was either the Super Bowl or an All-Star game they wouldn't get in Arizona in the 90s.
Because of this?
They got 30.
Yes, they did, ultimately.
All right. So they did it for an NBA All-Star game?
I don't know.
Okay, I thought I was watching the news. Let's see. In 1996, baseball owners unanimously approved interleague play, which would begin in 1997.
Bob, in 1992, voters passed on Martin Luther King's Civil Rights Day in Arizona. They were the last state in the union to formally install an MLK holiday.
Thank you!
And the reasoning
was... Point for Bob.
What do you know?
I don't really count it because it was sports related. He only knows it because of sports.
not true. Sport. You want to know how I actually know it?
Because you're a civil rights champion?
Yeah.
No, not that one
we
either.
Remember
no,
the
you
speech.
Don't want to
see it. Not? Here it is.
No,
don't
I'm
get
not.
Carried
don't
away now.
You're
I'm trying to remember what album.
You got a George Wallace
but this,
tattoo.
There's a full Public Enemy song called By the Time I Get to Arizona. And Chuck D definitely laid down some tracks on this topic.
The NFL disqualified Phoenix as the host city for the 93 Super Bowl.
That's why.
What's your role?
We'll give it
to
you in 3 years.
I bet you it's in there. I'm sure Chuck D didn't say anything bad.
No. He was nice. He was a nice rapper.
Yeah, he was a good fella.
And they kept him out of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame last week, we learned.
In 2014...
No, it was the Songwriters Hall of Fame.
Oh, okay.
The NBA fine... former Mavericks owner Mark Cuban, $100,000 for confronting referees and using inappropriate language towards them after the Mavericks blew a 17-point lead in a loss to the Clippers.
Poor Mark.
Yeah, that probably really hurt his pockets.
Right.
In 2015, Russell Wilson hits Jermaine Kearse for a 35-yard touchdown 3 minutes into overtime to lift the Seattle Seahawks to a victory over the Green Bay Packers in the NFC Championship game.
They Seattle, should have beaten the Cowboys that year.
Seattle was down 16-7 with 2 minutes remaining in regulation.
Made my son quit football for almost 10 years.
Are you serious? That game?
Wasn't that the Hasselback?
We're going to take the ball and we're going to win.
That was like 10 years before that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is Russell Wilson. And... Doug Baldwin?
Hasselbeck threw a pick six, too.
Yeah,
didn't
Al Harris.
Yes, to Al Harris.
Pretty cool. All right, P1 birthdays today. We start with, hey, Corby, I'd like to wish my lovely wife, Kristen, a happy 51st birthday. Kristen was a member of the SMU women's soccer team from 91 to 94. She's an avid V1 and would love to hear Jubb's laugh from the inaugural April Fool's Open.
That's sweet. Happy birthday.
Corby has no idea what's going on, but he loves it.
Jeb is falling that slow motion out of a chair.
That is the happiest moment of George's life.
I've never seen that in my life! P1 Stu says my nephew Aiden turns 14 today.
Yep.
His leader is the fake dude perfect. Drop request any fake dude perfect. Thank you and baby arm.
That'd be a good name. That'd be a good name for like a message board.
What?
P1 Stu.
Rats.
Maybe a podcast.
Yeah, with killer.
Dookie. Give me a smaller ball. Smaller. Dear God of trick shots, let this be the one. Popsy Weber! Moses Moody. I suck. You, Tyler.
Moses Moody.
There's a lot of Moses Moody.
Dude, perfect.
They're very contentious as a crew.
But they're up on the NBA lottery talking about Moses Moody.
Yeah.
All right. One more here. Dearest, most amazing and wonderful Monty, my husband Rockford is a day one P1. He is 53 today. We're headed to New Orleans to celebrate his birthday, my birthday, and our anniversary. We're leaving all 10 children at home to fend for themselves.
What?
They'd love to have sex.
Dude, that
seems like that's all they've done their whole life.
Unbelievable.
Also, the name Rockford, kind of badass.
Birch, can you tell me if the Cowboys will be playing in the Super Bowl in New Orleans this weekend so I can grab tickets? Also, his leader is Justin Fields. My husband's leader is the Monty Nub. Either way, let's see. He'd like to hear a Lion 4 guy joke, but I don't see a Lion 4 guy.
Oh.
Yeah.
So maybe just one more bouncing nub, and we'll call it good for Rockford. All right.
I want to hear more about Justin Fields being your leader. That's...
Just give him one more year.
Could be Caleb Williams.
Cliff. Bears OC.
Cliffy.
All right, birthdays today. Character actor MC Gainey is 76. He was in Con Air, Django, and Beer Fest. The Holy Triumphant.
Lando.
Kevin Costner is 69. John Dutton.
Drinking coffee.
Ticket Zone.
Waterworld.
Yeah.
Out on the front porch.
He was in Waterworld.
Best Costner movie.
A kind of tamed down Roy Tillman is John Dutton.
I'll tell you what. There's no question that when they had Roy Tillman walk out of his house with coffee on a cold day at the ranch, they were definitely thinking about John Dutton doing the same thing. That's the same shot.
Is it really?
It just makes you want to have coffee on a cold winter's morning. Out at your ranch.
And he just left it on the ledge.
And those are the only similarities you'd want with him and Roy,
right? We both have seen dead bodies.
Turning 64 today, Oscar winner Mark Rylance. Turning 61, drummer JoJo Mayer.
Of?
Chip and JoJo.
Not Chip and JoJo.
Of?
Verve?
Verve.
Yeah. Verve.
Not the Verve pipe.
Did the Verve do Bittersweet Symphony?
Okay. Comedian Dave Attell, 59. Director of Suicide Squad, David Ayer. Wrestler turned actor, Dave Bautista, 55. Actor from The Flash and Law and Order, Jesse L. Martin, is 55. Lando, Jonathan Davis is 53.
Korn.
Oh. He is the lead singer of Korn. Jason Segel, 44. And Katie White is 40. That's the lead singer of the Ting Tings. Sports birthdays, we have Mark Messier, 63.
Greatness.
Pep Guardiola, 53.
Also greatness, begrudgingly.
Julius Peppers, 44.
Hall of Fame?
Should be.
I would think so.
Yes.
Angelique Kerber, 36, the German tennis broad.
Tennis.
Ham. Michael Pineda, 35. Max Fried, 30. Leonard Burnett, 29.
Michael Pineda, 35.
Where's the time gone?
Dude.
Jake Ferguson, 25.
Sweet spot zone.
Hey.
Getting a little old.
A man who I wonder his sexual history with his father, Gary Trent Jr., 25.
Good dude.
Did that tradition pass down?
Yeah, have they had three generations of it? Like they're all three in the room.
Two chicks.
Yeah. All right, born on this day, now dead.
Four walls.
Cary Grant. Elijah Cummings. Ray Dolby, who invented the sound system. And Oliver Hardy.
Funny.
Dead on the stay still dead, we have John Tyler, the 10th U.S. President, Don Sutton, the pitcher, and David Crosby.
Oh,
sperm donor. 1 year ago today. And that, my friends, is why today doesn't suck.
Bye, Monto.
Bye, Miney.
Shut it down! Let's go home!
Get the Steak Podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
And here he is, Dave.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hi, and we also need to welcome our Thursday guest, our rant friend, Gordon Keith.
And you're only going to even find that.
Hello, I'm here.
What were you listening to?
Oh, I was watching a debate on God between a rabbi and Christopher Hitchens. The late Christopher Hitchens.
So that Gordon. Is the most Gordon thing.
Is that part of your snack?
Is that part of your Christopher Hitchens playlist?
I do love his voice, and he was a smart guy.
Gang gang.
I like Christopher Hitchens.
All right, finish your snack. So yesterday at this time, gang. We talked about
that's not me.
The lineup being announced. Your grinder's blowing up. I don't know if there's somebody walking by the bunker right now.
Yeah, hold on. I gotta go look outside and see who's walking by. See if they're hot.
So yesterday at this time, we talked about the lineup being announced for the 2024 Coachella Festival, headlined by Lana Del Rey, Tyler, the Creator, and Doja Cat, and a bunch of bands that, or artists, not even bands, that are pointed towards Gen Z and, yeah, and the Instagram influencer crowd that is now...
The non-instrument-laden band.
Yeah, a lot of laptops at Coachella. Well, the anti-Coachella announced a lineup today, that being Jazz Fest, the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival, which will take place April 25th through 28th, and then the following weekend of May 2nd through the 5th. And this is, I mean, this is Corby Fest.
I know.
So
Corby likes jazz?
No.
Well, there's certainly really New Orleans. There's New Orleans style jazz.
He calls it Americana.
In you know, the Preservation Hall Jazz Band and our friend Trombone Shorty. But here are your headliners: the Rolling Stones,
bingo.
Foo Fighters,
bingo.
Neil Young and Crazy Horse,
bingo.
The Killers,
bingo.
Oh my God!
Chris Stapleton, Widespread Panic,
bingo.
Oh my gosh.
This is out of control.
And then lesser in the Corby wheelhouse, The Killers.
Greatness.
John Batiste, Queen Latifah, Greta Van Fleet, Vampire Weekend, man. Bonnie Raitt.
Holy cow.
Earth, Wind & Fire, The Beach Boys, The Wallflowers, and they will also have a tribute set for the late Jimmy Buffett. And there's so many other bands as well. It's crazy.
But the top heavy of the Rolling Stones and the Foo Fighters and the Killers and Widespread Panic and Neil Young and Crazy Horse.
Oh, my God.
There's a massive text chain going on right now trying to figure this out.
How could you get that many acts in one festival?
Well, it's a four-dayer,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's Thursday through, and the Stones are already, it's their Thursday night of the second. So, like, the first weekend is X amount. Let's say it's $500 for a pass. The second weekend is, like, $800 because the Stones are only playing the second weekend, and they got to raise more money to pay for them.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you want a VIP pass or a full weekend pass, those are on sale, but single-day tickets aren't going to go on sale until next month.
Yeah. New Orleans,
man. So, Corby, are you looking for a hookup, or are you willing to pay for this?
No. I'm paying. Uh-huh.
But for the record...
Look out the window, Gordon.
Yeah, I just got a hookup.
For the record, one segment ago, he could not afford to take his wife to the World Cup.
Yeah.
Because he's spending
can go
all
to
the
this.
Money on Rolling Stone.
He can spend money on himself, just not on other people.
Right. And I do, I mean, I think you're the same way, Gordon. There's a love fest with the city in New Orleans. I don't get down there enough. I adore that place. I think it's such a magical city. And I feel like I get down there about once every 5 years or so. And every time I go down there, I'm like, God, I need to get back here more. And I never do. And this just seems like an easy path to execute that. Although it'd be a lot of times at the fairgrounds
instead of the city.
It's right. Lovely. It was fun. I went in November.
That's right.
When they moved the LSU game to 11, I said, perfect. Well, then we'll go to New Orleans. And it was great.
Did y'all go after the game?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hey, Gordon, have you booked your Vegas travel yet for the Super Bowl?
No.
He'll book it
Super
that
Bowl's
morning.
In Vegas?
That morning
There's
he'll
no
book
way
it.
He's done that.
I yes, just assume somebody would handle that for
the
me.
The Super Bowl is in Vegas.
Yes, I actually did. As wow. part of my effort to be a new me in a new year, I've actually been getting things done this year.
I'm proud
and,
of you.
I'm on a roll, yeah. Well, so I got that done a couple weeks ago.
So we know that Roc Nation is producing the halftime show, the Apple Music Super Bowl halftime show, as they took over last year. And they've already announced that Usher is the headliner of halftime. But now they have also announced the pregame artists for Super Bowl 58 in Vegas. Would you like to hear who's going to be doing the pregame festivities?
Yes.
And they usually carry this on the air, right?
Yes, yes. Okay. This is they may have like a concert outside the stadium, but that's not this. This is on the telecast in the stadium. So they will have a national anthem singer, an America the Beautiful singer, and a Lift Every Voice and Sing singer.
Okay, so it's going to be Robin Thicke until Tuesday.
Those are very poor guesses.
Till Tuesday. Amy Mann is great, though.
She is awesome. She that is, Magnolia soundtrack yeah, but she, is
but
wonderful.
She's going to get Till Tuesday back together.
Right, for this.
To sing Lift Every Voice and
guess.
Sing.
I already
okay,
know the
you
answer.
You guys are not making me feel very safe to take guesses.
I know the answer.
I want okay, to well, safe. The national anthem will be sung by Reba McEntire.
Reba?
Oh, God.
Didn't the Hammer have sex with her or something?
Did he claim that?
Who, me?
I think so.
It's very direct.
I thought that was
Tammy Wynette. I don't know. It's one of them.
America the Beautiful will be performed by Post Malone.
Do you think Posty was trying to hold out until the Cowboys got there, and finally he's just like, it's never going to happen. Might as well just do
well,
it.
Well, or maybe he thought that this was the year.
That's right.
Like Troy thought that they were going to at least get to the NFC Championship game.
Yeah.
And then Andrea Day will sing Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Who's that?
I don't know.
Like operate. What do you mean?
She is a
Young Gravy.
She's a legend.
She's won a Grammy for something.
You've never heard of her, Gordon?
Yes, I have.
What does she do?
She sang "Let Your Heart Sing," among other things.
Among other things. Yesterday we had the story that, or maybe it was the day before. Can't remember if it was yet. No, it was yesterday that Pauly Shore is going to play Richard Simmons in an upcoming biopic. Mm-hmm. So he's already. Yes. He's already playing Richard Simmons in a short film called The Court Jester, which will be screening at Sundance on the 19th, and then it'll later be available on YouTube. But
and that's Richard Simmons. Yeah, that's he's doing it in both, right?
Yes, yes. But there is an unrelated biopic, a full-length feature that will also star Pauly Shore as Richard Simmons. But I don't know if he has any recourse, but Richard Simmons is saying that he has not granted permission. So he posted on Facebook, he said, "Hi, everybody. You may have heard they may be doing a movie about me with Pauly Shore. I have never given my permission for this movie, so don't believe everything you read. I no longer have a manager. I no longer have a publicist. I just try to live a quiet life and be peaceful. Thank you all for your love and support."
Why did he need to add those on? Okay, what was it? It seems like it was only a couple of years ago that there was a story of Richard Simmons being hijacked in his own home by someone?
Like held, yeah, hostage by his caregiver?
He's gay! Yeah.
Like maybe they were cashing his checks or something?
Yeah, something really
weird. He came out and said that was not true.
Are you sure?
Yeah. Richard Simmons came out, released a statement saying, "I'm not being held hostage. I'm just living a quiet life and all that." But, I mean, I don't know what to believe with him. I do fear that something's going on with him. But he can't control whether or not they do a movie about him.
No. None of us can.
The Stern movie?
Will Pauly Shore ever play Dave Lane in the Dave Lane movie?
No, they will never make that movie.
And then Dave tries to get it stopped.
Yeah.
By saying he lives a quiet life.
Oh.
Did you know that
it sounds
that
like
Richard
your,
Simmons
your
was...
gape photos are getting a lot of hits.
My goatsy self-portrait.
No, what about Richard Simmons?
Oh.
Did you know that he was extremely happy back when you were watching him when you were a kid?
Gay?
Gay.
No, I didn't know that. But my grandpa didn't know that Liberace was gay.
Right. So, no one knew back then.
No. Yeah, my mom swore, oh no, Liberace, he's a total ladies man.
Right.
I don't think so.
All right, one last one before we get into some more risque e-news in the Rant Revival
by the
coming
way,
up next.
One of the more underrated movies of the last 20 years was the Liberace movie. That Michael Douglas is Liberace and Matt Damon is his young lover.
That was really
good.
Dude,
it was so much fun in that scene where Matt Damon kind of wakes up and Liberace's kind of staring at him in bed and he pulls the sheet up and he goes, looks like someone's awake.
Oh.
Well, speaking of movies, it was confirmed. It was confirmed on the Tonight Show last night as Jodie Foster said she was, in fact, offered the role of Princess Leia in Star Wars.
Really?
Hmm.
She said that she was already locked into a contract for a Disney movie and she didn't want to break it. And so if you look at her filmography and her timeline, it was probably Freaky Friday because that came out a year before Star Wars. And so think about how different Star Wars would be because Carrie Fisher was 19. They had to strap down her boobies. Because
aren't you a little short for Stormtrooper?
Yeah. Oh, right.
Hey, Clarice.
I couldn't wait for because I knew that would be the line. but yeah, she was Jodie Foster was only 13 or 14 at the time.
Yeah.
And so it would have been a very different Princess Leia. There would have been no sexual
green,
tension
huh?
with Han Solo.
With
there
her
would
brother.
Be no love triangle with her brother and Han Solo.
Weird. Why would they even offer that to her?
I always question those stories. It seems like actors are always coming out saying, oh, you know, that was, I turned down that role. And then you talk to the director and they go, no, that's not true.
Yeah, I mean, she was on like the first callback list, but she wasn't going to get it.
That makes me, oh, by the way.
I can smell your lunch, sir.
Yeah, she was a great big Wookiee, sir. that True Detective Night Country.
Yes. Good. Weird.
Way weird. Way out there.
Is it like the first season with occult stuff?
Yeah, it's really, really weird. But she is awesome. Like Jodie Foster is so good at it in one episode. So,
all right, coming
she's
up
fighting
next
with Jen Alpha right now. Did you know that?
Who?
Jodie Foster is at war with young people right now.
Why?
She just says that Gen Z is, or Alpha, or whichever one it is, the latest one, she just says that they won't work, and they all got mad at her and started attacking her online, I think it was a week ago.
She's probably not online, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, she probably doesn't, never heard of computer.
What's a computer?
All right, the Rant Revival is next.
Gang gang. Gang gang.
Said gang gang, sir.
Gang gang.
Where we have Gordon Keith with us.
Did you hook up during the break?
No, I didn't scare up any action during the break.
You did knock
I
one
know
out.
If I would make the.
Whoa!
Oh gosh, they're all coming out.
Very popular.
Here.
Has anyone done that before?
What?
Knocked one out during a break?
Yeah. Yeah, Davey used to.
No.
When he was overnight board hop, didn't you say you got busted doing that once, Davey?
No, but I did used to watch scrambled porn.
Go Dave.
You just see one random side boob, maybe for a second.
There was a button on the remote that you could press, and instead of it being all staticky and scrambled, it would show you the actual image, but it would be like a negative image.
Okay.
So you could see, but everything was opposite. It was like, you know, looking at a negative.
Yeah, right.
Jeez, that's the desperation.
Yeah, you just had to pass the time overnight board hopping.
You had to pass the time somehow.
But no, I did not deposit into a potted plant.
At Mockingbird.
Yeah.
The page boy haircut, the Prince Valiant look.
Yeah, that's when I was useful.
Was totally
tomato
useful.
Red.
All right, so we have E! News Jr. bleeding into the rant revival, as I have a few E! News stories that are more appropriate for the rant revival. First thing I want to talk about is Gordon's new favorite movie. At least I assume it is. Have you seen Saltburn yet?
You know, I haven't. I've not seen it.
It is so up your alley. Has anyone seen
Why
it?
Why is that?
You've seen it?
No. I have not. I was agreeing with him.
I guess I don't know what it is.
This has been recommended to me several times.
So it is on Amazon Prime.
Does it have lesbians in it?
And it stars Barry Keoghan.
Scissor me.
He's been in tons of stuff lately. He was in The Banshees of Inisherin. He was the son of the constable or the police chief or whatever.
Okay, I'm...
You would know him if you saw him.
Yeah.
And so he plays a private school kid who doesn't have any money, who befriends a rich kid who is the heir to an estate called Saltburn. This is in England. And he works his way into the favor of the family. And it's like a dark comedy and kind of a psychological thriller in a way. But Barry Keoghan, his character is insane. There are several scenes involving bathtubs, involving graves. And then there is a final scene involving him dancing through Saltburn in the nude. And the song that soundtracks this scene is a 2001 song called Murder on the Dance Floor by Sophie Ellis Bextor. And so it came out in 2001, but on the strength of its role in this movie, it has cracked the top 100, the Billboard top 100 for the first time. It's number 98 right now. But it is huge on the Instagram and TikTok because people are recreating the scene, the dancing through the estate. I don't know if they're doing it in the nude, but they are doing it to this song. You really need to watch this movie, Gordon.
So it's movie, not series?
It's movie.
Okay.
Yes. It's movie. It's long. It's super disturbing. It's super weird.
Now, is this going to be on TV?
I mean, it's not happiness level disturbing, but it's pretty disturbing. And I very much want to hear your take on it, Gordon.
God, back in the days of freaking VCRs and DVDs, the amount of happiness VHSs that were being thrown around up here from Gordon were unbelievable.
Right. That was his default gift. He just had a box of them at home.
Yeah.
And anytime it was any
Moonstruck,
any occasion.
Yeah. And you always wanted us to watch it with either our pastor or our in-laws.
Yeah. Hey, watch this with your in-laws if you're looking for something to do with them. That way you don't really have to talk too much, you know. Just watch a movie.
It's happy.
Put this on.
It's happy.
It's about a family.
Yes.
It's about a family, and it's about happiness.
White people.
Is that still the most disturbing movie you've seen, or is Saltburn more disturbing than
that? No. Saltburn is not. It's maybe half as disturbing as Happiness.
Did you see it?
Yeah. I don't remember when, but I finally...
Did you see it with Suegra?
I think I was... No. I think I was made to watch it to work at the Ticket. Because
seriously, it felt that way, didn't it?
Gordon had that in the handbook for a while.
And wasn't that in like late 90s, early 2000s?
Yeah.
I may have mentioned that movie once.
Oh, my God.
Like I promoted it constantly.
Oh, my God.
That and Idiocracy and...
I did promote that one quite a bit.
Yeah.
Buff Tanner.
I
Those
think,
are the three things Gordon used to
promote. Yeah, and that too. But not Happiness.
I think that next, or like inside of Lee Harvey Oswald's bathtub, are the postcards that Philip Seymour Hoffman squished against his wall.
Right.
That Gordon has all those.
All right. A lot of P1s haven't seen that movie. Don't ruin it for them.
I'm not. That's like the opening scene.
See if it's streaming.
He had a natural adhesive.
Yeah. Do you remember the question, Gordon, that the boy asked his father after the sleepover that the father had engineered?
Yes, just
Yeah.
Don't. It's too creepy.
We do. I do remember that. It's the worst question ever asked on film.
Dad's answer was creepy. Everything about it was creepy.
He just wanted to know if he was attractive to his own father.
Yeah.
Okay, Dave, come on.
Yeah.
It's your movie.
Yeah,
it's not my movie.
According to Keith Production.
It's Bob. Bob brought him from Lynchburg.
No doubt you have a producer credit in there, right?
From Gordon Keith film. From executive producer Gordon Keith.
No, we're talking about Saltburn.
Written and directed by
Gordon Keith.
Stop playing that sounder.
Speaking of the
new from Muser Films,
the themes of happiness. So there is a
1998 is when it came out.
Former reality star Survivor winner Nick Wilson is a state representative in Kentucky, and he had to take to Facebook yesterday and post a clarification after heavy criticism when he filed a state bill.
Hi, Claire.
That would have legalized sex between first cousins.
Oh, what?
Sex crimes. Maybe we shouldn't have been doing jokes while he was setting up the story there.
So his Facebook post, he says, during the drafting process, there was an inadvertent change which struck first cousins from the list of relationships included under the incest statute.
God, and there's an incest statute?
And I failed to add it back in. And then
That's Corby being offended by this law.
Corby says with disbelief.
So he said,
Corby talking to an officer who's putting cuffs on
him. Wait, what?
There's an incest statute?
No way.
The hard line. The show based on incest.
Like when?
Whoa.
In this state?
So
okay, but I saw that news story, and of the relationships listed, that was the least offensive of all.
Right. So he tries to clarify, saying that he actually was trying to broaden the law and have more inappropriate behavior be included under the statute. So he says currently, incest only applies in cases of intercourse. Mm. So sexual touching or groping by uncles,
Corby's about to finish.
Stepdads, or anyone with a familial relationship is not included in incest. My bill makes that kind of sexual contact a felony.
God, so much talking. Jack this guy.
That wouldn't be incest, according to the current Kentucky law.
Of course,
so you need to move to Kentucky.
This is coming out of Kentucky.
He says, I understand I made a mistake and sincerely hope my mistake doesn't hurt the chances of the corrected version of the bill. It's a good bill. I hope it will get a second chance. So he added cousins back into the list of perpetrators.
Smash! Do you think a lot of people travel to Kentucky to see that incest statue?
No, Corby, I think you're misunderstanding
You're totally confused.
What? The word is statute.
Oh.
Statute.
Oh.
What you thought it would be
where's that cool statue about incest?
When you envision
that the dead
an incest statue, what do you picture?
Cousins. Kentucky. All of it.
I prefer not
cousins. In a hayloft.
Not in all caps.
Do you think they got like a really famous sculptor to do the incest statue? Wait a minute, what? You're gonna pay me to do what? Yeah, it's Kentucky.
All right, and finally, there's a big holiday coming up.
Boy, the confusion.
The next holiday that's already in stores.
Blanking Day?
Well, I mean, it could be. If your cousin is your Valentine.
Okay, but if cousins, first cousins, same age.
Here we go.
Adults. It's a religious law that we have, right?
It's a gross law. No, I mean, there's lots of
gross things that are legal.
Well, it's a proper law.
Back in the day, first cousins were fair game.
Corby Davidson.
Yeah. So why is that? Why were they fair game then? Isn't God's law eternal?
They weren't fair game. It literally ruined Jerry Lee Lewis's career.
Well, I'm saying before that.
Them fair game.
Before that.
Okay, you're talking about like...
In the old world.
In Game of Thrones days, if that was a period. Gross.
I'd like to pin Dave down.
If that was an incest, period.
Right.
Quote, pin Dave down and do what to him?
Quote the old world. I just would like to hear the when that started.
I don't know.
What's the last year of the old world?
From like the
right when Cobain killed himself.
From like the most evil times
when grunge hit. When the apostles were listening to Pearl Jam.
So if you are looking for a Valentine's gift for your cousin, Kim Kardashian's lingerie company Skims has something that you might be interested in.
What's that?
They have a one-size-fits-all novelty set of
camel toe
edible underwear.
Ugh.
A $34 bra and $24 matching panty.
Made of Funyuns?
That's made of fully edible candy.
Bugles.
God, what if that's the flavor they chose for the edible underwear was Funyuns?
So then you go down there and it smells like two bags of Bugles?
Yeah. It's like total onion crotch.
It's the Funyun. It's kind of a fail save.
It's not me. It's the Funyuns.
Oh, yeah.
Have you ever seen a pair of edible underwear?
I feel like that was part of like 80s.
You would see it in like Spencer's, right?
Or something like that. But yeah, but did you know anyone that
I feel like it's fictional
that bought it and then was like, yeah, man.
It's like a fruit roll up, isn't it?
I don't know.
Like you have to gnaw into it.
I know. That's like beef jerky.
I remember when my first cousin got some.
All right.
And he wore them, but
he did.
Yeah.
Underneath the statue.
I mean, I got full halfway through.
And then you made him finish.
That's the other thing. It's like you're eating the underwear, and then you're like, you know what? I'm full. I'm done.
I'm gonna vomit all over you.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So it is made of fruit roll up stuff, right?
In my head, yes, it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You should go visit the incest statue and put fruit roll ups over their genitals.
Would that make headlines?
Bob, did you predict that sentence was going to be said today when we started Night Revival?
No, I did not.
If
I did not see
climbing
that.
On the incest statue, eating a fruit roll-up off a wiener.
You're holding the cellophane in your teeth, trying to pull it off.
Is that Corby?
While desperately trying to keep yourself going.
Right.
The other Harvey Davidson, the ticket.
All right, we need to let Gordon answer his grinder, and we need to listen to some audio next.
And by the way... it's 7:35 tonight. Twitch.
That's right.
.tv/actualGordonKeith.
Is George
Dave Lane may make an appearance, and you may see the appointment that I almost missed the rant for was getting my hair cut, and she butchered it.
Oh my god!
I don't think my hair has been this short in forever.
Oh no!
He looks like old Monk.
Yeah. Please get that haircut.
Three Stooges
woman,
hair.
But it is a tiger.
All right. Thank you, Gordon. We love you. There he goes. Gordon
Keith.
Another week of the rant.